Welcome to a special edition of Informed Sources on News Channel 3. I'm Richard Ransom. Thanks for joining us. It's a special edition because tonight we're sitting down with the author of a new book that's a must-read if you follow Memphis politics and want some valuable insight into what makes our city tick and the role race has played in all of it. Let's show you the book's cover first. It's titled From Boss Crump to King Willie, How Race Changed Memphis Politics. And do you recognize the name of the author on the cover? Well, you better if you're a regular viewer of Informed Sources, because it's none other than News Channel 3 political commentator Otis Sanford, a native of Mississippi. Otis has spent decades as a journalist covering Memphis politics before he retired as managing editor of the Commercial Appeal, and showing you can be busier in retirement than at any time in your life. He does his daily commentaries for us, of course, a weekly column for the Commercial Appeal, squeezes in teaching a class or two for the University of Memphis, and somehow managed to research and author this just-released book. So, Otis, thanks for being here and,
thank you,
and talking
Richard.
About
thank
all
you.
Of this.
Thank you.
Exciting time. You know, we live in an age where, you know, bookstores are closing and people are going to Kindle and not reading a book. But what's it like to actually see your name on a hardcover like
I can't describe it, Richard. It's a dream come true. I've always wanted to write a book. You know, any journalist feels like they have a book in them anyway.
Right.
And even non-journalists. But when I first got the book from a publisher, University of Tennessee Press, and held it in my hand, you know, and I don't mind saying this, even though I'm a big grown man, almost a tear came into my eye. And I thought mostly about my parents, my mother and father, who taught me everything there is to know. Now I dedicate the book to them, along with my wife. And so it was just a wonderful feeling to just have it in my hand.
How did you decide on the topic?
Well, actually the topic, the title kind of evolved. I first started wanting to call it From Boss to King. I'd had that in my mind for a long time. I started thinking about this book even back when I was working full time with the paper. But when I left to go to the university and to come here at Channel 3, I started thinking about it even more. And then I got a call from UT Press asking, had I ever thought about writing a book? I said, absolutely, I have. They said, send us a proposal. We don't have a lot of West Tennessee books, especially about politics, mm-hmm. so I did. But my original title was From Boss to King. But I discovered during that process that that may have been a little confusing, because I talk about Dr. Martin Luther King in the book, and I didn't want anybody to misconstrue what I was saying. And then my publisher sort of tweaked it a little bit, said, no, we need to call this, we need to put the names in there that they know. Boss Crump to King Willie.
We also got B.B. King and King of Rock and Roll.
Exactly.
Lots of kings in Memphis.
Got a lot. The Elvis Presley and all of that stuff. So.
Well, I found it a fascinating read, and you know, you and I are political junkies,
yeah.
so you know,
yeah.
we're going to like it no matter what. But you know, even folks who have just kind of a passive interest in Memphis and what makes it tick, like I said in the introduction,
right.
are going to find a lot of really neat information in there, lots of detail that really gives some insight in how the city is what it has become. Mm-hmm. In fact, you mentioned, I think early on in the book, where you talk about how Charlotte and some other cities that are very similar demographically seem to have dealt with the race issue in a more progressive way and faster than mm-hmm. Memphis has been able to. What is the reason behind that as you see it?
Well, you're right, Richard, I do. And I try to make some comparisons because I wanted to broaden it out just out of Memphis and Shelby County anyway. And so I do make some comparisons, and I mentioned Charlotte, I mentioned Louisville, I mentioned Nashville, I certainly mentioned Atlanta, which from the racial demographics, Atlanta probably has the closest relationship to Memphis. The fact is, Memphis has always had an issue and a culture that revolved around race. That is just a fact. And it's primarily because of where Memphis is situated. We're right here at the top of the Delta. We are surrounded by Mississippi and Arkansas. And during the Great Migration, when African Americans were leaving the plantations of Mississippi and Arkansas, and even some respects Louisiana, and were headed north because they were just tired of the plantation life, the oppression and all of that. Well, a lot of them went even further north, but a lot of them stayed here, settled right here in Memphis. And so Memphis has had to deal with racial issues going all the way back to just after the Civil War. and especially with the infamous Memphis massacre that I talk about in the book. So Memphis has always had that issue where Charlotte didn't necessarily have it. Charlotte doesn't have the population, African-American population that Memphis has, neither does Louisville. But they were able to progress when Memphis, unfortunately, has let race sort of hold us back from progressing when it shouldn't have. We could have embraced our diversity, agreed to have some equal opportunity around here and progress, but we didn't do that.
What role, and we're gonna, I don't want to get away from our main topic, which is some of the crazy mayors we've had over the decades, but what role do you think the assassination of Dr. King played in exactly what you're talking about?
Oh, I think it played a tremendous role, Richard. I mean, at the time, and then again, we're going to talk about the mayors, but when Dr. King was killed, the mayor of Memphis was Henry Loeb. Henry Loeb was the most unforgiving or stubborn mayor I think that we've ever had. He was not about to let the sanitation workers even try to tell him what to do in terms of government, and he was backed up by the local newspapers.
Here's a picture of him behind his desk, and if people look closely, there's a shotgun beneath his desk. This is one day after the King assassination.
Yes, it is.
Picture was taken.
That's an infamous photograph. It's in the book. It was also published in the Commercial Appeal at the time. But the way how that shaped the demographics now, it is one of the two major things that I talk about in the book that led to white flight. And I'm not saying white flight in a negative way. It's just that that's what happened.
And that's not a uniquely Memphis thing.
And it's
either.
Not a uniquely Memphis thing, but it happened. I think it happened in larger numbers in Memphis. Primarily because of those two incidents, the assassination of Dr. King in 1968 and the decision to impose court-ordered busing in Memphis in 1973 and 72, 73, 74. That also sent white Memphians to the suburbs of Shelby County and DeSoto County, and that changed the political and racial demographics of Memphis, the voting demographics as well.
Okay, so let's get to the mayors. We're gonna kind of go from back to front in terms of timing here, because you end with the swearing in of Dr. Willie Harrington, who was the city's first black mayor of
first any elected
consequence.
Black mayor.
Yes, and you know, that was quite an event. We're showing video of the swearing in right here, and there was so much that went on behind the scenes there. You talk about the People's Convention in 1991, and the fact that there were just, you know, there was just a real struggle in the
office
city about
of mayor.
Who was going to be elected, and people who've been here at that time remember it was a nail biter that election night.
Oh, it was. It absolutely was.
So
that
help me
I spend the entire last chapter of the book talking about that entire episode, the People's Convention, the fact that Mayor Harrington, in a very strategic way, sort of called out, if you will, Harold Ford, who I mentioned prominently in the book, who was a congressman at the time,
Harold Ford Sr.
Harold Ford Sr. Right, to put together a summit to try to come up with a consensus black candidate for mayor. They all knew that the demographics had changed. It changed with the 1990 census. For the first time, African Americans made up the majority population and the majority voting population of Memphis in the 1990 census. So 1991 was the year, and everybody knew it. And so that's what happened in terms of Mayor Harrington getting Harold Ford Sr. to do that summit, while at the same time you had Shep Wilburn and Vernon Ashe and Teddy Withers trying to put together this People's Convention. Well, the People's Convention is what ruled the day, because Harold Ford Sr., you know, sort of was foot dragging a little bit to get that summit done. And the People's Convention, they voted to nominate, if you will, Dr. Willie Harrington as their candidate.
Yeah, it's funny, when we talked about this earlier, you felt that the quest for Dr. Harrington to be school superintendent, when he was denied that, was one of the pivotal moments of his career.
Oh, no question about it. I mean, here's a guy, and I spend the last three chapters of the book really devote heavily to Dr. Harrington. Dr. Harrington did all the right things. He grew up in the city of Memphis. He grew up in meager surroundings right over here at Barton Street.
Yeah, we have a picture of him on Crump Boulevard and
right.
Third.
Right, yeah, Crump and Third.
That's number 11, folks, where he was. That's where he grew up.
Exactly. And he did all the things that society said you should do. Get an education. Work hard. Try to achieve something. Well, he did all of that. He got his degree, undergraduate degree at Lemoyne on. He got his doctorate at Southern Illinois. He got into the teaching profession. He did everything coming up through the ranks. He was a protege of the then superintendent, John P. Freeman. John P. Freeman methodically appointed him deputy superintendent to sort of put him in the position to be the superintendent after John P. Freeman would retire. Even that caused a problem with the white school board members, Memphis City school board members, because they thought Dr. Harrington was a radical because he participated in the Black Monday protest in the late 1960s to get some equity with African Americans in the school system. But in 1978, when John P. Freeman retired, Dr. Harrington was one of, I think, about five or six candidates who were vying for the job, and the school board rejected him, even though he had done everything to prepare himself to get that job. And they went instead to a candidate from Grosse Pointe, Michigan. And if you know anything about Grosse Pointe, Michigan, it has no comparisons to Memphis.
Yep.
And the community, Richard, just got up in arms. I mean, they even met Mr. Coates out at the airport and said, these were parents of students saying, we don't want you here.
Mm-hmm.
We know who we want as the superintendent. They flooded the school board. They really, really rose up.
And this is not really an activist community. Most people would not describe it as such. That was something that
They did then. Yeah. And again, I was a reporter here at the time, and while I didn't cover a lot of that, I wasn't covering education, I certainly was paying attention to it. Dr. Coates rejected the offer, and then the school board eventually got around to offering Dr. Harrington the job.
Well,
it really kind of soured him a little bit, but he took the job, and of course he stayed in the schools, in the superintendent of the schools for about 13, 14 years.
And was mayor for longer than that.
Right.
Love him or hate him, you cannot deny a very savvy politician,
right.
And certainly commanded a lot of respect by the
people
who voted for him, for sure.